Scripture proof on that is 1 John chapter 5, verse 13 and 14, that says, now is the confidence that we have in him.
Right.
That if we ask anything according to his will, we know that he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we shall have the petitions that we have asked. God also designed man to live the abundant life in Christ Jesus according to John chapter 10, verse 10, that affirms that Jesus came that we may have life and have it more abundant. Church, we are not designed to face life in fear or doubt. When God created mankind, his chief end for man is that we glorify him and enjoy him forever. And to do this, we must first accept Jesus the Christ as our Lord and Savior, and then follow God's word as a blueprint for living. To be able to glorify God and to enjoy him forever will also mean we must learn how to be content in all the varying circumstances that we encounter in life. Jesus said it like this in Matthew chapter 6, verse 31 through 33. He said, therefore, do not worry, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For after these things the Gentiles seek, for your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But I love this last part. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. When you become a person who knows Jesus as your Lord and your Savior, when you come to know your mission and your purpose in life, and you engage in perpetual prayer and thanksgiving, you will experience contentment. So in the text and the Holy Spirit as my guide, I'd like to share with you two object lessons regarding the subject, contented in Christ, who provides all my needs. Object lesson number one. The secret of contentment is not found in something, but in someone. Look again at verse 11. It says, not that I speak in regard to thee, for I have learned in whatever state I am to be content. Now, first of all, Paul was under house arrest. And unlike a person who would be incarcerated in jail today, they are what's called a ward of state, meaning that the state must provide for that person who is incarcerated their basic needs, food, water, clothing. But in Paul's day, it was actually up to the prisoners themselves to see that their physical needs were met. So Paul founded, when he founded the church at Philippi, he is God's called out pastor. He's God's called out evangelist and missionary. So the Lord's people at Philippi sent Paul multiple financial gifts. As verse 10, which we didn't read, states in that verse, Philippians 4:10, and Paul said, your care for me has flourished again. And although Paul was used by God to establish other churches, and he was used by God to feed the sheep in other pastures, the church at Philippi was the only church that gave Paul some necessary assistance. So the question should come across our minds is, where were the other pastors? Where were the other churches Paul founded and fed the word, especially the Jerusalem church that Paul presented a large financial gift to in 1 Corinthians chapter 16? Youth and children and adults alike, a whole lot of people with their church at Philippi was the first church that Paul started on European soil. And just like a parent-child relationship, it's not strange that they were the only one in a time of need to show up in Paul's life. But no, Paul took his need to the Lord first. And then the Lord addressed those needs on certain people who were in the church at Philippi. And then the end result was spiritual giving rather than high-pressure giving. They didn't have to get into church and make a plea. They didn't have to come in with a dissertation to say why they should help Paul. When they first said that Paul was in need, and they knew Paul was the one who had founded and started the church and was sharing the word with them, and he was in need, they instantly wanted to give. And what is even more amazing is when Paul says, he says, nope, not rather that I speak in regard of me. Some of your translations may say not that I speak in regard of want. Paul is saying, I'm not destitute. This letter to the church at Philippi was not Paul trying to connive and get more money out of them. Paul was simply wanting his friends to know that there was contentment before the gift arrived, and there was contentment in his life after the gift arrived because of his fellowship with Jesus. If you want to grow spiritually, you're going to have to learn how to be content. The word content literally means to be self-sufficient or to be satisfied. But Paul takes this word to an entirely different level in this passage. Unlike the Stoic philosophers of his day who taught self-sufficiency and contentment, that it all came from self, from oneself, Paul taught sufficiency and contentment comes from being a person who is in Christ. Gives Paul taught contentment from the perspective of being Christ-sufficient, not self-sufficient. Therefore, a practical definition of contentment could be it's a state of satisfaction that is anchored to our confidence in God, in His Word, that results in a joyful celebration of life despite whatever the circumstances you may find yourself in. This text affirms we are not born content. We must learn how to be content. Look with me closely at verse 12. Now I'm going to read it first from the New King James Translation again, and then I'm going to read it a second time from the New Living Translation. Verse 12 says, I know how to be abased, and I know how to abound. Everywhere and in all things I've learned to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. Now since this is you, the children's Sunday, I want to put in a plug to you parents that it is very important that your children have a Bible translation that they're going to better be able to understand. Because if they're reading some of the language, especially, and I'm not putting down the King James, I'm just simply saying that if that is the only translation that they have, they're not going to always be able to understand all of the terminology that they're going to read. Therefore, I encourage you, in addition to your King James translation, if that is your primary one, for your children, and particularly for your youth, that you also get them a New Living Translation. Now, when they go to school, they have 3, 4, 5, 6 different pairs of tennis shoes, multiple shoes, etc., etc. You don't send them there with one pair of shoes, one basic anything. Why is it that we sometimes, when it comes to the most important thing that they need to know, and that is Jesus Christ, that we won't arm them as sufficiently as we could? That's verse 12. I know how to be abased. I want to do them simultaneously, so I'm going to read it again. And I know how to abound. Everywhere and in all things I've learned both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. Now this same verse in the New Living Translation, matter of fact, it's such a good translation, it actually would give you commentary on what you just read if you read it out of the King James, or even the New King James to some extent. In the New Living Translation, verse 12 says, or empty, with plenty or little. When our children and our youth read it in that way, they will have a better understanding of what they just read. Because a base that amount doesn't mean very much to a 7-year old. And because they may not understand it, they're going to miss a key concept that Paul is trying to teach. Because this word abase simply means to run low. Anybody ever ran a little low? Ran a little low with money, you know, got more meals and the money at the end of the month. Well, but this, that's what abase means. It means to run low. And abound means to overflow. It means to have more than enough. This word learn is a very interesting word in the Greek. It literally means to be instructed or initiated through trial and testing. Paul was initiated into the wonderful secret of contentment in spite of poverty and in spite of prosperity. Paul had learned to live in complete detachment from his circumstances. Since his circumstances were all ordered by the Lord, all was well. God's will was good, acceptable, and it was perfect. Paul had learned through his mature faith in the promises of God that he could be content whether he was running low on funds, which means to be abased, or if he was overflowing, abounding. Paul learned to be content whether he was chained to a prisoner or while he was a church player. He learned to be content whether he was writing a theological masterpiece like Romans or while he was waiting before the court to see Agrippa and others whereby his court sentence could have been death. We must learn to be content because of who we trust has the final verdict. Church, all of us can learn how to be fully content with who we are, with what we are, and what we're doing. But let me say this. Don't learn to be content in sickness.
All right.
See, we can take this verse and we can massage it so it fit us. I'm not married, I'm not getting married, and I'm content living just like I am. That's not what Paul talking about. I'm mad at her. She's mad at me in the marriage. I'm not going to forgive her. I'm content just being mad and sitting over here this morning by myself. That's not what Paul is talking about. The contentment that he's talking about is a contentment that is in Christ. So if it's in Christ, it can't be in sin. Practically speaking. And I like to shut the corn all the way down to the top. To become content, we need to learn how to be more grateful than what we already have. Yeah. The 10th of the 10 commandments commands us not to covet. So often people are trying to keep up with the Joneses, trying to impress people they don't really know. We ought not to lust after or to long for with great desire something that belongs to somebody else. I don't have to covet what you have because the same God that gave it to you, if he desires, he gives you. Matter of fact, whatever you have, he able to give me if he desires even something greater than what you have. So why? What I need to learn how to do is to celebrate when God bless somebody else. I need to learn how to be happy when you get promoted, even if I don't. I need to learn how to be thankful for what I have. When you get there, then God can trust you with something else.
Amen.
In order for us to be contented, we need to learn how to count our blessings instead of just counting how much cash we have. Yeah. Now, you may be like me. You may not have a whole lot of cash. But I tell you what, I got a whole lot of blessings. And if you invest it carefully, so do you. We are all by not using some of your time, talents, and financial to focus on people and not just positions. Contrary to the commercials we see, the best thing that we can give our children is quality time, not material treasures. It is our physical presence, not material presence, that will matter most to our children. To be content, we got to look beyond the temple to that which is eternal. What does it profit me to gain the whole world, but then lose his soul? Because he did not accept Jesus as his Lord. I don't care what you have. When you close your eyes on this side, none of it follows. When you get before Jesus, he's not going to ask you one question about how much stuff you obtain. You may get some questions about what you did with it, but what you obtained is not most important. Object lesson number two. Everything God calls you to do, he provides what you need. I'm going to say that everything that God calls you to do, he provides. Let me know. Look at it in verse 13. It says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. These seven little words, if understood and believed by faith, will enable you to overcome any obstacle, conquer any and every challenge, bear any burden, shoulder any sacrifice. Now, this is a verse that can easily be taken out of context. You see, to be able to do all things, what that really means is all things God calls you to do for kingdom advancement, and all things God purposes for your life. The power we receive in union with Christ is sufficient to do his will and to face the challenges that arise from our commitment in doing his will. God does not grant us superhuman ability to accomplish anything we can imagine without regard to God's word and God's will. As we strive to do things God is calling us to do that represent a change in the status quo, especially in the house of God, we face troubles, pressures, trials. Most people don't like change. We don't like to start over. We don't like the idea of changing the status quo. Which really, if you really knew what status quo meant, you may not say it so much, because status quo is Latin for the mess we are in. And yet God, our God, is forever stirring up our mess. He always want to move us out of our comfort zone. He always want to redirect our steps. He loves to change our circumstances so that we never ever become too comfortable or stuck in our ways. God is always striving to take us higher and deeper in him. God cannot bless us with everything he wants to all at one time. We believe in it. So he constantly brings change, valleys, mountains into our life to challenge us to trust in him and to ask for his strength to do what may seem impossible. Now, since this is children and youth, sir, let me say to our children and youth, never allow anyone to limit your godly dreams and your godly ambitions. Don't let anyone tell you you can't do something God's word promises that you can without you replying, I can't do all the things through Christ who strengthens me. The God we serve is able to not only provide you a job, but a career. He can only give you a job, but he can also help you own your own business when any derogatory names that somebody else may call you that make you feel like you can't do all that God has designed you to be. It's not about what other people call you. It's about what you answer to. And you need to know beyond shadow or doubt that God says that you are made in His image. He says you are fearfully and wonderfully made. There is nothing that is impossible, nothing too hard for God. God has a great, has placed great value in you. You know what? I'm holding before you right now. $20 bill. They see it from the back, just trust me. $20 bill. Now you know something about this $20 bill? It's a $20 bill because its creator, the U.S. Treasury, stipulates that it's worth $20. The creator of the document says it has value. And the value is $20. I can take this $20 bill in the room and ball it up.
It's
a promise God promises only to those who have walked down know what that role is? That it starts at Romans 3:23, where often of sins and falls short of the glory of God. It moves on down to Romans 6:23 that lets us know that the wages of sin is death.
Yeah.
And then it goes on down to give us the good, give us the first piece of the good news, but God demonstrated his own love to us that while we were still too mean to live and not fit to die, while we were still on the crack pipe, while we were still whoremongering, while we were still setting up, while we were still lying, while we were still cheating, while we didn't have Jesus on the grave, Jesus had already come to the cross and died for every last sin that has been committed and will be committed. But they don't come automatic. The Bible says in 1 John 1:9, if you confess your sins, he's faithful and just to forgive you of your sins and cleanse you from unrighteousness. So the forgiveness of sin doesn't just come automatically. You have to confess it. Then he will automatically forgive you. Paul came to understand when you seek first the kingdom of God, God will add and God will supply all your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Paul, then you got to remember also that Paul wrote this text under the guise of talking about sacrificial giving. When he said God was going to supply the need, the reason he was saying that is that he was saying, look, I know you all have made a sacrifice to give to me to help me in my need. And because you made a sacrifice to help me in my need, what God is going to do is fulfill what you just gave. He'll, matter of fact, he might even give you more than what you gave me. So understand that this verse comes on the heel of sacrificial giving. That's why God is promising he will give you what you need because you just gave me God. Luke 6:38, I love my Jesus, listen.
Yeah.
Jesus said, give, and we'll be given to you. This good measure pressed down, shaken together, running over, will be put in your bosom. For with the same measure that you use, it will be measured back to you. Give him a little, then he'll give you back a little. You give a lot, he'll give you back a lot. Now your motivation takes me, I'm going to give a lot, and I expect God to show up tomorrow with twice what I gave. Everything with God is a matter of right reason and the right purpose, that you can rest assured that if you give for the right reason and the right purpose, God says, I will provide for your needs.
Amen.
Church, I can say based on the word of God, I can testify from experience, we can trust God to always meet our needs.
Amen.
We were made for more than what we have seen. Yes, there's some giants in the land. Yes, there's some enemies in the land. But God is able. When we learn how to be content with what we have, until God decides to give us more, we will experience the choices of his blessings. When we realize who has the final say in all our matters of life, we'll say like the songwriter said, it is well with my soul. No matter what my lot, it's well with my soul. You see, we can be sick and have a bad report from the doctor, we can praise the Lord.
Yeah.
Or we can be healthy and all is well and we still praise the Lord. Yeah. Church, I can. Church, you can. Church, we can. Do all things through Christ who strengthens us. Therefore, I am contented in Christ who provides for me. Mighty and everlasting. I bless you. I thank you that I know that you will do what we are reading. I thank you that I have many, many testimonies of how you have shown up in the 11:59 hour and always have come through. And Lord, because you've been doing it, I know you will keep on doing it. But I pray, Father, that we will recognize that we don't have to live in fear, don't have to live in doubt. Everything that you promise us, you will do in your So I pray that we live a surrendered life to you. In your matchless and mighty name, I pray and give thanks. Amen. 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 Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Here.